2 Timothy, no, let's go to 3 Timothy. 2 Timothy chapter 3. I'll get it in a minute. Amen. 2 Timothy chapter 3 verse 1. Now the word of God says, "This know also that in the last days perilous times," or difficult times, "shall come." How many thinks we're living in difficult times?
Amen.
Now here's the reason why we're living in difficult times. "For men shall be lovers of their own selves, covetous, boasters, proud, blasphemers, disobedient to parents, unthankful, unholy, without natural affection, truce breakers, false accusers, incontinent, without self-control," is what that means.
Amen.
"Fierce, despisers of those that are good."
Amen.
"Traitors, heady," conceited, "high-minded," conceited, "lovers of pleasure more than lovers of God."
Yeah.
But listen to this. "Having a form of godliness,"
yeah,
"but denying the power thereof, from such turn away."
Yep.
From such turn away. We're not to have fellowship with those who claim to be children of God and are not. Sure, we're to present the gospel to the world. That is our call, to go into all the world and preach the gospel to everyone. God wants all to be saved. As I looked at those scriptures and I began to realize, in America, we've been so greatly blessed, but we've been so concerned in the past 8 years that we've been trying to get to be politically correct.
Yeah.
Our morals have declined because of that. There's rising debt, $20 trillion worth.
Yeah.
It's not a Democratic thing or a Republican problem.
Yeah.
It's a problem, amen, with the soul of mankind. The Bible says if my people,
yeah,
would humble themselves and pray, then they would hear from heaven and God would heal their land if they turned from their wicked ways. I believe, amen, that America was founded upon Christianity.
Amen.
I know our last president said that America was not a Christian nation, but I beg to differ with him. I believe it was and still is. In fact, 52 of the original 56 who signed the Declaration of Independence were avowed Christians. There were no Buddhists, Mormons, Muslims present at that time. Those are simply the facts. Amen. And these men were devoutly religious Christians as well. It is interesting, as it is informative, to look at some of the quotes from our founding fathers. Those quotes indicate the founders' strong sense of Christian value and their perceived importance in the foundation of our nation. And I believe God has given us a space of grace. I believe, amen, since we've elected President Trump, whether you voted for him or not, I believe he's going to be a tool in the hand of God. And I believe because of that, God's given us a little space of grace. Many of you might not realize it, but we are living definitely in the last days. Amen. I believe we're living in those times when we can read in the book of Revelation and it's being revealed to us the meaning of the things that are in the book of Revelation that used to be mysterious to us. We know now that the black horse, huh? We know who that is. It's capitalism. We know, amen, that red horse is communism. We know that white horse represents the Catholic Church.
Yes.
The Pope Mobile's white, the airplane's white. All the things he has, his robe is white. And if he had a horse, guess what color it'd be?
White.
White. So we know that. But we had problems with the pale horse. What is a pale horse? Well, that was a misinterpretation in the word when they wrote the King James Bible. That pale horse is actually a green, pale green horse, which represents the Muslims. And the Bible says that death and hell shall follow them. And that's exactly what happens. They're trying to pull us into conflicts right now. They're trying to get a caliphate. They're trying to go into the world and conquer everyone, especially Christianity. They are against Christians. But thank God, amen, God is for us. So who can be against us? Amen, nobody's going to win against us because God is for us. So what are you saying, Pastor? I'm saying I believe God's given us a little space of grace, amen, some time where we can begin to have revival. And I believe we're going to have a great awakening, Brother Charles, before it's all over with. I think we're right on the verge of the rapture. It can happen any moment. There's no more prophecy to be fulfilled. We're right on the verge of the rapture. But I believe that God is first going to do something because he's coming for a bride without a spot or blemish. That word spot always refers to sin. That word blemish always refers to sickness. Amen. The church today, if you listen to my phone, I can show it to you. It's full of sin and it's full of sickness. Everybody's sick. Everybody's caught up doing something, amen, they shouldn't be caught up in. But let me tell you something, you better get ready. For in an hour that you think not, your Lord doth come. Amen. He's not going to tell you when he's coming. The Bible says he himself does not know even when he's going to return. That's given to the Father and the Father alone. But I believe the Father's getting ready to say, son, go get your bride. Amen. But before he does, I believe the bride of Christ is going to have to rise up, amen, and begin to shake itself and begin to awake itself. Get out of that slumbering sleep, amen, and begin to cry out to God with a voice of unity and begin to see God move in their lives, in their homes, and in their families and watch God do the miraculous. We're not going out of this world, Sister Mary, broke as a joke and messed up in our minds and ill in our bodies and our spirits decaying. We're going out with victory. Amen. George Washington said, it's impossible to rightly govern without God and the Bible. John Adams said, the general principle upon which our founders achieved independence were principles of Christianity. Andrew Jackson says, the Bible is the book upon which our republic rests. James Madison said, religion is the basis and foundation of our government. John Adams, amen. Patrick Henry says, it cannot be emphasized too strongly or too often that this great nation was founded by Christians, not on religious beliefs, but on the gospel of Jesus Christ. This nation was founded upon the gospel. The Bible is worth all the books, he said, that's ever been printed. Abraham Lincoln said this, the Bible is the best gift God ever gave to man. James Madison said, a nation that will not be ruled by the Ten Commandments shall be ruled by tyrants. The future of America rests not in the laws of this Constitution, but in the laws of God. The Supreme Court struck down from our public school prayer in 1962. And Proverbs 14:34 says, righteousness exalteth a nation, but sin is a reproach to any people. What have we seen since prayer was taken out of school? We've seen the schools be given over to gangs and drugs. You can ask me, you can dispute it if you want to, but I worked there for many years and I know I made more arrests in that high school than I ever made on the streets in all of my career. I made drug busts on a continual basis all the time. They came to school not to learn, but they came to school to sell drugs. Prayer was something that stabilized those children. Prayer was something that helped them realize they had a direction they needed to go, and that direction was a direction of living for God and having some principles and morals in their life. You know, some of you might say amen this morning. You know, if it's legal, then it's okay. No, it's not. They've legalized gay marriage. They've legalized killing babies. They call it abortion. It ain't nothing but murder. They've legalized drugs. They've legalized a whole lot of things. But making something illegal does not make it right in the sight of God. Can somebody say amen? Hallelujah. I'm preaching better than you're shouting this morning.
Glory.
We have a space of grace. Isaiah 5:20 says, "Woe unto them that call evil good and good evil, that put darkness for light and light for darkness, that put bitter for sweet and sweet for bitterness." Proverbs 29:2 says, "When the righteous are in authority, the people rejoice, but when the wicked beareth rule, the people mourn." I don't know about you, but the last 8 years, I was mourning. Amen. Mourning to see our country go so low in its morals. I mean, to see it just begin to collapse. And that's where we're at today. I don't know if you realize it or not, but we have about approximately $20 trillion in national debt. That's $125,000 for every home that's represented here today. Amen. To pay off that debt, how many of you got $125 to give the IRS so you can get your debt paid off? We don't have that. But the problem isn't just with the $20 trillion. The problem is with the $150 trillion of unfunded liabilities. Amen. Illinois, the retirement programs that they give to people. Amen. We got to realize that has to be paid for somehow by somebody. And when you can retire making almost as much money as you made when you worked, that's a problem, because that retirement didn't make up that much money. We're living longer. They started Social Security at 65 because they thought you would die.
Come on.
No. Vietnam veterans were supposed to all be dead by 2015. So they figured, well, it don't make no difference that we messed them up with Agent Orange and we vaccinated them with things that cause health problems. That doesn't make any difference. We'll get rid of them by 2015 anyway. What year is it now? 2017, the Vietnam veteran stands before you preaching the gospel this morning. They miscalculate a lot of things, and that's why we're so indebted today. And see, we're indebted to other nations like Red China. There's that red. Red Russia. There's that red. Communism and socialism. We have people today that's trying to support the New World Order like George Soros, who likes communism, who likes socialism. But you can't show nowhere in the world that socialism and communism ever worked. They've killed millions and millions and millions of people, and yet that still does not work. It doesn't play, because it's only for the rich. It's not for the poor nor the middle class. They don't even have a middle class. That's why America's hated so much, because we still have a middle class. Matthew 24:12 says, "And because iniquity shall abound, the love of many shall wax cold." People are going cold because of sin. Sin is running rampant. You can look at the billboards and there it is. You can turn on your radio and there it is. You can turn on your TV and there it is. You can power up your computer and there it is. You can look at your phone and there it is. Sin is running rampant in the world and in the United States of America. We sit here today, amen, realizing that some people say, "I was born to homosexual." Well, how about the adulterer? Was he born an adulterer? How about the thief? Was he born the thief? How about the murderer? Was he born to murder? No, the Bible says in Romans 3:23, for all have sinned and come short the glory of God. But it also says in Romans 6:23, for the wages of sin is death, but the gift of God is eternal life through Jesus Christ, the Son of the living God. Can somebody say amen? No, you weren't born that. The Bible says in Psalms 51:5, it says, behold, I was shapen in iniquity, and in sin did my mother conceive me. So we're all born into sin. We adopt different lifestyles.
Right.
Amen. The adulterer wasn't born an adulterer. The drunkard wasn't born a drunkard.
Right.
The drug addict wasn't born a drug addict. You're not born that, you're born into sin. And those characteristics come as you live your life and make your choices. See, the Bible says choose life or death. Choose blessing or cursing. Choose, amen, God, if you want to live. But the devil came to steal, kill, and destroy. If you worship and serve him, and you will worship him, and you will serve him if you're not serving God. Read the book of Revelation. It says all.
Yeah.
All, small and great, rich or poor, free or bond, all. A-L-L, all. That means exactly what it says. You don't have to be a great theologian to understand it. Everyone that's not worshiping the Lord, amen, is serving the devil. We're going to watch in these next few years, I believe, people begin to stray and fall away and begin to adopt, amen, a world religion. Even those that call themselves Christians. Why did Jesus say when they asked him about the signs of the times of the end? He said in every place that they asked him, first thing, don't let anyone deceive you by any means. Then what did he say? He said, many shall come in my name and deceive many. What's his name? Jesus Christ. How could they come in his name? They come in Christianity. They come in the guise of Christianity. Some of the people that we watch and admire so much may be those that are swept into the world religion. Some of those may already be in the backgrounds making deals with the government to go into that new world order. You know, if Bush Sr. said, we have this great opportunity and we shouldn't let it go to have this new world order. Henry Kissinger said about President Obama, this is a great opportunity. We've raised him up for such a time as this to bring in the new world order. What is the new world order? It's one world government with a one world religious system, with a one world monetary system, where you take the mark of the beast or they're killed for not taking it. And I know I'm going to hear it. Well, I'm just going to wait and to be killed. You can't even wake up and come to church on time, some of you. Let alone be killed. Oh, I'm on fire for God. No, they set you on fire. Amen. You know, I listen on Sunday morning to all these petty little excuses. You're not ready. You're not ready. You're not ready. It's over 40 years, and God is still getting me ready. I've learned recently I can't live for you. I just got to preach to you. I've learned recently I can't make the decisions I'd like you to make so you can be blessed. I can just tell you about the decisions I made and became blessed by them. See, I can't do that for you. You have to do that for yourself. Over a long journey, I begin to realize, amen, that God is going to help those, hallelujah, that rely upon his word and live his word. It's not just about reading the word. It's about loving the word. And the Bible says, because they love not the truth, God turned them over and gave them up to a reprobate mind. Because they love not the truth, He sent them strong delusions that they would believe a lie and be damned for believing it. Why? Because they didn't love the truth. What is the truth? It is the living word of the living God. Can somebody say amen? As pastor, I've given so many Bibles out, I can't even know how many it is. But I wonder, out of all those Bibles I've give out, how many of them's been read? Yep. Oh, you said, I read mine. It's red. I'm not talking about its color. I'm talking about, amen, reading that Bible. Yep. I'm talking about learning that word. Because you don't have much time to go. Amen. And if you don't make it right now, you ain't going to make it right there. Because you're not going to get but one opportunity. The Bible says, amen, there's a payday for sin. Romans 6:23, the wages, there's a payday. You're going to have to one day, amen, stand before a holy God and give a report on why you lived your life the way you lived it. Oh, he loves you. Pastor, you saying I got to be perfect? Well, if you are, you're better than me, because I ain't. No, but you got to be persuaded that you're not going to give up, that you're not going to give in. See, what you can't do, God's already done for you by Jesus Christ, his son. Can somebody say amen? Amen. It's wonderful knowing the Lord. See, because he never leaves you. He doesn't forsake you. Amen. You heard Brother Charles's testimony. Counting on God. Yeah, you may fall into situations. You know, might not know, amen, that Matt's going to get into an automobile accident. But thank God, the injuries, amen, are not life-threatening. He walked away from, or didn't walk away from, carried away. But one day he will walk again by the grace of God. And I believe it's changed Matt's life somewhat. I believe those become reference points in your life. See, amen, when I fell down those stairs, Brother Charles says, life won't never be the same. It wasn't, amen. Every day you wake up and you thank God that you got another day to live, another day with your family. It motivates you onward to the Christian, amen, life that God wants you to live. But they'll come in the name of Christianity. And they'll try to deceive many. Revelations 5:9 says, for thou wast slain and hast redeemed us to God by the blood out of every kindred and tongue and people and nation. What can wash away my sins? Nothing but the blood of Jesus. What can make me whole again? Nothing but the blood of Jesus. Amen. In every situation, you begin to plead the blood of Christ upon your life and upon your home and upon your family and finances, and God begins to move. Amen. I believe in the blood. And I believe without the blood there is no redemption. There's no payment for sin. But he redeemed us by his precious blood. He's the spotless lamb slain from the foundations of this world. God sent him, amen, because the first Adam sinned and messed up. And all since then we've come in and we've been born into sin. But that second Adam, his name is Jesus Christ, the Son of the living God. Amen. Lived a perfect life, a holy life, and died without sin, and took your sin and my sin upon himself, that we, amen, could be bought back from the chains of darkness, delivered from the jail of hell, and set free by the power of the living God. Can somebody say amen? What are they doing today? Earth worship. Animal worship. Come on. Romans 1:25 says, who changed the truth of God into a lie and worshiped and served the creature more than the creator, who is blessed forever. Amen. 2 Thessalonians 2 verse 9. Even him who is coming after the working of Satan with all power and signs and lying wonders, and with all deceivableness of unrighteousness in them that perish because they received not the love of the truth, that they might be saved. And for this cause God shall send them strong delusions, that they should believe a lie, that they all might be damned who believe not the truth, but had pleasure in unrighteousness. Just like I read in 2 Timothy, we're living in a day and a time when men have a form of godliness, but deny the power thereof. It's not about ritual. It's not about formality. It's about the power and the presence of God in your services. I read an article where a girl said, amen, her husband died of cancer. But she said, we didn't need the coffee shop. I didn't care about when I came in church. If I could smell fresh roasted coffee beans. Amen. Making coffee. I didn't care they had a couch on the platform and lights were flashing everywhere. I didn't care anything about that. And I don't think they cared about my husband. Amen. They just preached little pretty messages with catchy titles. That's not what we need. We need the anointing of God. We need the power of God. For it is the anointing that destroys the yoke of bondage. Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
Go back to Romans, the 25th chapter, and look at verse 26 through 32. For this cause they worship of the creature more than the Creator. And God gave them up unto vile affections. For even their women did change the natural use into that which is against nature. I know young women brought up in the house of God. Some had leadership positions in the church. Now married as lesbians. Still go to church. Oh, still say they're saved. Still say they love the Lord. But let me tell you something. If you love God, you're going to live for Him. Amen. You're going to live according to the Word of God. And right here it tells you they gave up that natural affection. And they went into unnatural affection. I want to tell you something. It can be anybody. Amen. You allow lust to get out of control. It's never satisfied. The Bible says, can a man take coal into his bosom and not be burned? Amen. The eyes are the window of your soul. David said, I've set nothing before my eyes that's going to cause me to sin against my God. Let me tell you something. When you get out in the world and you begin to dabble in the things of darkness, amen, you've been delivered from the chains of darkness. You need to let that world alone because that lust and desire will overwhelm you and overtake you. It won't be natural. It'll be unnatural. We say all the time, everybody's welcome in Miracle Temple. But we don't change our message for nobody. I ain't baking you no cake and putting two women on top of it. Or two men. The other day, passing through the channels, I seen and heard that a daughter had fell in love with her dad. Oh, and they loved each other, and they were having sex, and young girl. I thought to myself, what sickness has corrupted the minds of people? But see, folks, that's in the Bible. It's called incest. And when you let lust get out of control, you're out of control. You might think you can handle it. Oh, I'll just look at this little bit of porn here. I can handle it. Ain't going to be much. Amen. I just need a little porn in life. I'll just take a little bit of dope. Let me tell you something. All that stuff will lead down the road of destruction. There is a broad way. Amen. And God says the road that leads to life is a straight way. Amen. That broad way leads to death and destruction. The devil wants you to take the broad way. Oh, it's a way, amen, where you think you can maneuver easily and make it to where you want to go. But it's the hard way. The Bible says the way of the transgressor is hard. But Jesus said, take my yoke upon you and learn of me. For my yoke is easy and my burden is light. You want an easy way, amen, take the straight way. Yes, you may face some obstacles, but you'll overcome them in Christ because you're more than a conqueror in Jesus Christ. Greater is He that's in you than he that's in the world. And likewise, also the men, leaving the natural use of the woman, burned in their lust one toward another. Men with men working that which is unseemly, and receiving in themselves that recompense of their error, which was meet. In the Greek, it's interpreted necessary, because a necessary punishment's coming when you violate the law of God. Amen. And even as they did not like to retain God in their knowledge, God gave them over to a reprobate mind to do those things which are not convenient. Being filled with all unrighteousness, covetousness, maliciousness, full of envy, murder, debate, deceit, malignity, whispers, backbiters, haters of God, despiteful, proud, boasters, inventors of evil. What happened in Noah's time? The Bible says their minds was constantly and continually on evil. When they couldn't find something evil to do, they invent something. And that's exactly the time we're living in right now. Inventors of evil. Amen? So they're without understanding. Covenant breakers. Without natural affection. Implacable, unmerciful, who knowing the judgment of God, that they which commit such things are worthy of death, not only do the same, but have pleasure in them that do them. The youngest of the young now are being taught in elementary school about their gender. You know, keep your opinions to yourself. Government-run institutions have no business trying to tell a five-year-old what gender they are. Amen. They got these kids so confused, and confusion is not of God, the Word of God says. And they got them confused. Amen. We go to Naperville sometimes. It's rampant all over the place. One guy, seen him all the time. We seen him several times dressed up as a woman. Amen. And went to up in Michigan, seen three old men older than me. Amen. Nylons on, high heels, dressed up like women. Amen. I thought squirrels were squirrely up there, but I'll tell you something, there's more squirrels up there than you want to deal with. Amen. Nuts. Hey, hallelujah. I'm telling you, we're living in a perverse time with some perverted people that don't have the morals, amen, nor the moral insight to begin to realize Jesus is coming, and it's coming as soon, and they better begin, amen, to take heed. I'm glad none of you is looking at the clock. We jumped ahead an hour. That means I get another hour. Romans 16, verse 17 and 18. I'm not leaving this for 2 days. Two sermons. I'm going to complete it today. And I beseech you, brethren, mark them which cause division and offenses contrary to the doctrine, which ye have learned, and avoid them. For they that are such serve not our Lord Jesus Christ, but their own belly, and by good words and fair speeches deceive the hearts of the simple. We're too busy trying to be politically correct, listening to the world and not to God. Matthew 24, verse 3, 4, and 5 says, "And what shall be the signs of thy coming and the end of the world?" And Jesus answered and said unto them, "Take heed that no man deceive you, for many shall come in my name, saying, I am Christ, and shall deceive many." 2 Timothy 3:1 says, "This know also, in the last days perilous times shall come." Not might come, shall come. Amen. Romans 25, you'll find in verse 51, having a form of godliness. That's in 2 Timothy also. Amen. It says, from such, turn away. Don't have anything to do with them, because they're people that's going to try to confuse you. The Word of God says in verse 3, I believe it is chapter 3 of 2 Timothy, "For the time will come when they will not endure sound doctrine. But after their own lust shall they heap to themselves teachers having itching ears. And they shall turn away from their ears from the truth, and shall be turned unto fables." What happens when you walk out of church, amen? You turn your ears. But hopefully you don't turn them from the truth. But so many do. Back to America, we have turned from the truth and embraced the lie. We will allow little fish to stop the farming of thousands of acres. A little spider to stop the farming of thousands of acres. The government moves in and takes land that does not belong to them, that belongs to people, over a spider or over a small fish. We will create a dust bowl. Because why? We worship the creature more than the creator. I believe that God gave us this world and he knows exactly what's going on. And this world one day is going to be refined by fire. The Bible says heaven and earth shall pass away with a great fervent heat. Amen. But I believe that God is going to refurbish this place. We're going to live in this place. And it's going to be a wonderful place. Hallelujah. Can somebody say amen?
Amen. Glory.
One of the candidates for president said, we need to eliminate 1 billion people from earth because of the overpopulation. The same one made millions off the lie of global warming. Now climate change. Before, it was going into an ice age. There's approximately 7 billion people on Earth. You could give each one 4 acres, put them all in Texas, draw water from the Great Lakes, make Louisiana a septic tank, and farm the rest of the world, and we don't have a population problem. You ever been up in an airplane? You see little bitty cities and all of a sudden vast land everywhere. That's all over the world. We don't have a population problem. I told you, you can give everybody in the world 4 acres. Make Louisiana a septic tank and draw water from the Great Lakes and farm the rest of the world. We don't have a population problem. We have a sin problem. Can somebody say amen?
Amen.
Many come in his name, Christian, but he does not. But they do not know him. We need to get back to God and see America have a revival before the end. Abortion on demand. Illegal aliens spending out of control. Approaching $21 trillion, $150 trillion unfunded liabilities. How long can it last, folks? They will not give up until they see the one coming after the working of Satan himself. All-out war being declared on Christians. Have you ever realized why we've become so unpopular in the last 8 years or so? I mean, we've always had the battle, Sister Mary. But never before have we been tried, they've tried to silence us in such a way. Brother Charles, they've tried to silence us in every way they can. By lawsuit, by jail, by everything. They're trying to silence us. But we got to have that voice. And we got to set that trumpet to our mouth and cry aloud. Can somebody say amen?
Amen.
The Bible says that that one, that Antichrist, is one that changes the time and the laws. Who tried to do that? Your last president. He changed times and laws. And somebody said, well, he's out of office now. He's still in Washington. Still in Washington, building a big wall around his house. He still has a shadow government that he's still controlling. He can still become the head of the United Nations, which might put him as the head of the world government. Folks, we don't have a whole lot of times. Daniel 7:25 says, and he shall speak great words against the Most High and shall wear out the saints of the Most High and think to change times and laws, and they shall be given into his hands until a time and a time and dividing of time. But the judgment shall sit, and they shall take away his dominion to consume and to destroy it unto the end. Verse 27, shall be given to people of the saints of the Most High, whose kingdom is an everlasting kingdom, and dominion shall serve and obey him. Every knee shall bow, and every tongue shall confess that Jesus Christ is Lord of lords. Can somebody say amen? We're living in a time and an age when soon, very soon, we're going to see all those knees bow and all those tongues confess. The Word of God talks about that war. And talks about men's eyes disappearing in their sockets, their tongues melting in their mouth, their flesh melting from their bones. A hydrogen bomb is what does that. Guess who's trying to create one right now? North Korea and Iran, who's now getting the ability to to launch such a weapon. Guess who just sent B-52 bombers to South Korea? Your president. You know what a 52 bomber does? It carries those big bombs. Amen. We're right on the verge of something happening. Some of you are projecting years down the road and thinking about what you can do and what you can gather and what you can keep. I'm looking for Jesus to come. Amen. None of this worldly stuff matters. Only thing matters is what you do for the kingdom of God. Not what you do to yourself. Don't become your own Lord and your own Savior. Don't listen to those who are trying to get you to be politically correct and still call yourself a Christian. Don't agree with the devil and think God, amen, is going to bless you. It ain't going to happen. Would you stand to your feet?